The January 6th committee is weighing the possibility of criminal referrals against Donald Trump and his allies, specifically involving whether or not Republicans committed wire fraud and if Donald Trump actually committed a crime when he sought to, as the New York Times reports, obstruct the Electoral College vote count. Now, this news is coming just off of other news that a grand jury has been convened in New York to indict Donald Trump or his organization and or his organization on fraud charges. Now, if you were to ask me, I think this would be the logical conclusion of the January 6th committee. They initially start by saying, we were just trying to get an account of what happened on January 6th. And now they're saying, well, maybe we want some criminal referrals. When the first criminal referrals were made, it was against, I believe it was Steve Bannon, because he refused to cooperate and testify and provide documents to the January 6th committee. Now, I was of the opinion that this would never move forward. The committee, sure, they can make a criminal referral, but is the House actually going to vote on it, even with a Democrat majority? And the answer was yes. And Steve Bannon actually was criminally charged for contempt of Congress. Now they're making moves against many other Trump allies. Considering this is happening at the federal level, considering what's happening in New York, one could say that Donald Trump is just truly too corrupt to run for president again. I mean, the speculation is that he's going to run in 2024, with many of his allies saying, no, he's legit going to run in 2024. Or it could be that they are pulling out all the stops to make sure Donald Trump cannot run again. Because I'll tell you, one thing is true. Democrats absolutely are panicking. I don't think they have any real arguments against Trump, against his policies. I mean, you can make arguments against his character. But Trump adopted many populist positions that Democrats needed, and they didn't know how to run against him. You take a look at Bernie Sanders in 2008, Hillary Clinton in 2008, and you'll see they're talking about border barriers. You got Bernie Sanders talking about open borders being bad. You've got populists left and right talking about helping the American worker, and Donald Trump adopted those policies, and the Democrats didn't have anything left to run against him. So now, we are seeing a wave of Democrat retirements in Congress, and this means, considering what we already know about a coming red wave, it's substantially more likely Republicans will take the House in 2022 and the Senate, and then come 2024, with Donald Trump running for the presidency, Trump will get his second term because Joe Biden is basically out. Many high-ranking Democrats, many Democrat strategists have been saying they do not believe Joe Biden will run again. And if he doesn't, who could they possibly get? Hillary? Yeah, I don't know about that. Kamala? She couldn't even get one delegate. Maybe Pete Buttigieg, but he doesn't really have the star power. If Donald Trump does run in 2024, he wins. And the establishment knows this. Or at the very least, they're believing it is extremely likely he does win. Maybe he doesn't. I think it's likely. And so what do we get? Obstruction. Everything they accuse Trump of potentially wanting to do, imprisoning his political rivals, they are now doing, pulling out all the stops and playing dirty games to make sure they do not lose power. But it seems inevitable, especially with the coming red wave that has been predicted. Maybe not. We don't know. I mean, I think 538 says it's likely, but who knows? We got a full year. Campaign season is set to begin in about a month, and many people are already campaigning. But with around 23 Democrats retiring and only about 13 Republicans retiring, major advantages for the Republicans are here. And the Democrats must be scared they're going to lose power. And Donald Trump might win again. And what happens if Trump does win? Trump will take the gloves off. I mean, he brought on so many bad people. John Bolton's the best example. He didn't fire Fauci. What do you think he's going to do if he wins the presidency this time? Now he's got experience under his belt. He's witnessed what happened under Joe Biden for the next term. He's going to come in and he's going to say enough. And then it'll get bad for the establishment, at least. So let's read the story and see what's going on with the January 6th committee. Before we get started, head over to timcast.com. Become a member if you'd like to help support our work. As a member, you're basically funding all of the journalists that we have on board and the opinion pieces that get written, as well as all of our shows, including this one, Pop Culture Crisis, Tales from the Inverted World. If you like the work we do, please become a member at timcast.com. But don't forget to also subscribe to this video, subscribe to this channel right now. Share this link wherever you can. It really, really does help. We don't have the massive marketing budget of these big conglomerate media companies. We just have you guys. If you believe in the work that I'm doing here and what we do at timcast.com, share as much as you can. Now, Let's get into that first story. The New York Times reports January 6th committee weighs possibility of criminal referrals. The House panel is examining whether there is enough evidence to recommend that the Justice Department pursue cases against Donald J. Trump and others. Now, I want to pause for a minute, okay? And I want to talk about some language here. They're weighing the possibility of criminal referrals. Does that mean that Trump is facing criminal charges? I believe the answer is yes. They're trying to go after him and get criminal charges. But I want to just point out, not that I think it's not likely. I just think we're at phase one. Or I should say January 6th committee was phase one. They start filing subpoenas and doing their investigation. Phase two is now they say, oh, geez, oh, no, look, there's potential crimes here. We need to now upgrade from an inquiry to a criminal investigation. The next phase will be, I believe they will be making criminal referrals. Then it will go to the DOJ, and maybe Trump will actually be hit with criminal charges. But I believe it is fair to say that the goal here is to present Trump with that, the potentiality, or I should say the inevitability, at least in my opinion. But I could be wrong. At the very least, in New York, I believe Trump will be indicted. Let me say that again. I want to pull up how New York grand juries work, and let me just stress this point. They're going to have 23 jurors, potentially. They need only 12 to believe probable cause a crime may have been committed. There will be no judge, and there will be no defense. And if 12 of these grand jurors find probable cause, a probable cause, I mean, think about how low that standard is. Trump will be indicted. That means a cop walks past your car and says, maybe I smelled pot. That's probable cause. Probable cause is his car was swerving. Think he's under the influence. Yeah, I think Trump will be indicted. But let's read the story from the New York Times. They write, when the House formed a special committee this summer to investigate the January 6th Capitol assault, its stated goal was to compile the most authoritative account of what occurred and make recommendations to ensure it never happens again. But as investigators sifted through troves of documents, metadata, and interview transcripts, they started considering whether the inquiry could yield something potentially more consequential. Evidence of criminal conduct by President Donald J. Trump or others that they could send to the Justice Department urging an investigation. That move, known as sending a criminal referral, has no legal weight, as Congress has little ability to tell the Justice Department what investigations it should undertake. But it could have a substantial political impact by increasing public pressure on Attorney General Merrick B. Garland, who in his first year in office has largely sidestepped questions about what prosecutors are doing to examine the conduct of Mr. Trump and his aides as they promoted baseless allegations of voter fraud. And I'll stress this. I did not believe, and many did not believe, that the criminal referrals would result in actual charges against Steve Bannon. But they did it. So I think they're absolutely willing to go to these lengths. Now, it's pretty serious to try and stop Trump doing this, using this tactic. But I believe they've already proven me wrong in their willingness to actually file the criminal referrals and then have the DOJ go after these people. They go on to say, the questions of criminality go far beyond the contempt of Congress referrals that the House has sent to the Justice Department for Mr. Trump's former chief strategist, Stephen K. Bannon, and his former chief of staff, Mark Meadows, for their refusal to cooperate with the investigation. According to people briefed on their efforts, investigators for the committee are looking into whether a range of crimes were committed, including two in particular, whether there was wire fraud by Republicans who raised millions of dollars off assertions that the election was stolen, despite knowing the claims were not true, and whether Mr. Trump and his allies obstructed Congress by trying to stop the certification of electoral votes. Now, I'll tell you this. Republicans who claimed that they believed there was fraud in the election, raising money off of it, but privately said they didn't think so, that would be fraud. Now, show me evidence of that occurring, and I'll agree with you. Absolutely go after those people. Because there were a lot of people saying things like, we got to get to the bottom of this, and we got to investigate this. And if they were privately saying something else, well, there you go. Defrauding people to raise money. I'm not saying it's true. I'm just saying, prove it. They say it's not clear what, if any, new evidence the committee has that might support a criminal referral, when and how it will determine whether to pursue that option, and whether the committee could produce a case strong enough to hold up against inevitable accusations that it acted in a partisan manner. Behind the scenes, the committee's day-to-day work is being carried out by a team of 40 investigators and staff members, including former federal prosecutors. The panel has obtained more than 30,000 records and interviewed more than 300 witnesses, including about a dozen last week, whom committee members say provided key testimony. In recent weeks, the committee has publicly signaled its interest in the question of criminality. Shortly after obtaining from Mr. Meadows 9,000 pages of documents, including text messages and a PowerPoint presentation, the panel's top Republican rep, Liz Cheney of Wyoming, read from the criminal code at a televised hearing. She suggested that Mr. Trump, by failing to stop the violence at the Capitol on January 6, might have violated the federal law that prohibits obstructing an official proceeding before Congress, except Donald Trump issued a statement saying stop. So I don't know what they're trying to claim, other than they're just trying to make sure Trump can't run again. They're trying to drain resources from Trump and his allies. Quote, "We know hours passed with no action by the president to defend the Congress of the United States from an assault while we were trying to count electoral votes," Ms. Cheney said, adding, "Did Donald Trump, through action or inaction, corruptly seek to obstruct or impede Congress's official proceedings to count electoral votes? The question is one of the most significant to emerge in the first 6 months of the investigation. The panel has nine House members, including two Republicans, but let's be real, Republicans will put in air quotes. It plans to hold televised hearings early next year to lay out for the public how the pro-Trump Stop the Steal movement helped lead to the Capitol riot." Now, I personally believe, as always, if there's wrongdoing, by you know, absolutely, people should be indicted. They should be charged criminally for wrongdoing. But I genuinely believe this is mostly about draining the resources from Trump allies and trying to hurt them, because we've got a very serious election coming up. Historically, we should see Republicans win, because with Joe Biden, a Democrat, as president, people will flip, vote the other direction. Upset with how things are going, they'll say, we need Republicans in charge because the Democrats didn't cut it. I don't know if that'll actually happen. I think the people who are coming out and saying Republicans are guaranteed to win are making a big mistake, because you have no idea what's going to happen. The rules were changed and never changed back. So universal mail-in voting still exists, and this provides a huge advantage to Democrats because they can go door to door in dense urban areas and easily get more votes than Republicans could doing the same tactic in the suburbs or in rural areas. But let me show you what's going on with Mr. Alex Jones. NBC News says, Alex Jones sues January 6th committee in bid to evade deposition. The committee is scheduled to question the InfoWars host on January 10th. Alex Jones came out. He said what they're trying to do, I'll paraphrase here, I don't want to put words in his mouth, but my understanding of it was, he said they wanted to trap him, basically. You get him in there, you tell him under oath, tell us what's going on, and then if he gets anything wrong or makes a misstatement, whatever, they'll accuse him of lying and then refer him for criminal charges. So he said he's going to plead the fifth. NBC News reports, Alex Jones is suing the House. The lawsuit seeks to block the bipartisan panel. You see how they do that? Bipartisan. But no one on the right supports Liz Cheney, for the most part. They say moving forward with his deposition of Jones on January 10th and to void the committee's subpoenas for documents and phone records. The suit says Jones has offered to submit documents and answer written questions with written responses, adding, the select committee has refused to accept that offer and insists that he appear in person for a deposition. The lawsuit also says that Jones, the founder of InfoWars, on which he is a prominent host, plans to invoke his Fifth Amendment right to stay silent if he is forced to testify, that the committee is violating his First Amendment rights as a journalist. I like how they put a journalist in quotes. I am going to offend everyone on the left. Alex Jones runs a news organization. I'm not necessarily going to call him a journalist because I think there's pundit, and pundit might be a better term to use. But InfoWars is a news and media organization. The content that he covers is news. You can say he's wrong. You can say he's lying. Okay. Then we'll have a question about, to what extent does someone have to lie before you would say they're not a news organization? Because, I mean, we can take a look at CNN or the New York Times. What people don't like, and I said this before, is that InfoWars writes a bunch of droll, run-of-the-mill news as well. And then Alex Jones has his bombastic show. So the fact remains, I'm not here to talk about the credibility of InfoWars. I'm here to say it is a news organization. By all means, call it whatever name you want to call it. Insult them, put journalist in quotes, fine. Alex Jones has a First Amendment right to publish what he wants to publish. Quote, Jones has a good and substantial reason to fear the Select Committee may cite him for contempt of Congress if he refuses to answer its questions on grounds of constitutional privilege, the suit says. In a letter to Jones last month, the committee's chair, Benny Thompson, said the committee had evidence that Jones was involved in the planning and funding for the rally at the Ellipse before the riot, and that he was supposed to lead rally goers to the Capitol. The letter also said that Jones heavily promoted the rally on his shows, including referring to then-President Trump's tweet that the rally would be wild and one of the most historic events in history. But Alex Jones was not talking about a riot at the Capitol. He was talking about a rally. The January 6th committee is conflating all of these things together to make it seem worse than it is. Many people attended a rally. Most of them did not go to the Capitol. You see what they're trying to do. Now, the reason I bring up Alex Jones here is because he's correct. In this story from MSNBC, they say Liz Cheney's roadmap for a Trump indictment tied to January 6th. It appears many individuals up to and including former President Donald Trump worked hard to obstruct an official congressional proceeding. They say on January 6th, Congress met to conduct an official proceeding, the counting of electoral votes to certify, electoral college votes certify Joe Biden. But that proceeding was interrupted. As the House Select Committee investigation into the Capitol riot progresses, a vivid picture is emerging. It suggests many individuals, we get it, including Donald Trump, worked hard to obstruct that official congressional proceeding. And I believe, as do other legal experts, that doing so constitutes a federal felony. I believe Alex Jones is correct. They're seeking to take information from him to effectively indict him. And he has a Fifth Amendment right not to self-incriminate. There you go. As does Donald Trump. But the story is plain. Liz Cheney's roadmap for a Trump indictment is tied to January 6th. This is a very interesting way to frame it, MSNBC. You're saying that she had a roadmap to indict Trump and it's related to January 6th. That is to imply that her roadmap for indicting Trump is unrelated in a sense, like she was going to do it anyway, or she wants to do it and she needs January 6th. Sounds to me like the goal of this is just to get Trump indicted. By all means, people on the left and Democrats will say, good, Trump is corrupt, he's a fraud, and this is the path she's taken to finally take him down. And I think many others would just go and say they're really trying to stop him from running again. Trump is the opposite of perfect. Trump is a deeply flawed individual. He's got a bad attitude. And I believe, as I've always said, he embodies the worst of American culture. And I'll tell you this. You give me Hillary Clinton. I'll tell you what's really funny. In 2016, I didn't vote for Trump. I didn't vote for Hillary either. I didn't care. I was like, they're both bad. And the left was like, you think Hillary is worse than Trump? Oh, boy, do I. But for different reasons. And now I look at it and I'm like, look, Trump is bad, but he's not that bad. Not like Hillary Clinton or Joe Biden. Now you can see how bad things are really getting. So come 2020, I did vote for Donald Trump. Absolutely, I did. And I supported much of his second term agenda. But I'm not a big fan of the guy. What I mean by that is there's a lot of things that he does that I like. I think he's funny. I think he knows how to whip up a crowd and all that stuff. But I'd prefer somebody else. I'm not even a big fan of Ron DeSantis. But considering what he's done with COVID in that capacity, I am. I'm not a fan of traditional conservative politics, but I am a fan of getting things back to normal. And what's going on is anything but. I believe that Democrats are exploiting a crisis for political power and gain. And at the very least, Ron DeSantis could technically be doing the same thing, but at least he's doing it in the right direction and people are freer in Florida. You can take a look at Texas, some other states, and some other states that are doing the right thing. So if it came down to a 2024 election, yeah, I would prefer not to see Trump run, as would many people, many, many people, because Trump had a bad attitude. I don't know if I would vote for Ron DeSantis either, to be completely honest. But given the options, depending on what occurs, we'll see. I really hope Dave Smith ends up running for the Mises Caucus Libertarian Party, and I might actually support that. But again, we will see. I think this country is faced with an existential crisis. I don't believe that supporting either Democrats or Republicans is going to get you out of this. But here's what we can see. It's becoming increasingly likely that Republicans are going to win the House in 2022. We're going to see them potentially win the Senate as well. And this is going to change things dramatically. Joe Biden will still be there to veto. But if we see a red tsunami, the veto will be meaningless. And boy, will things get spicy. The Hill reports members of Congress not running for re-election in 2022. They say several House members are seeking other offices, such as in the Senate, or their state governorships. But other lawmakers are citing decennial redistricting and the increasingly toxic environment in Congress. So far, 23 House Democrats have indicated they aren't running for re-election, along with 13 House Republicans. Across the Capitol, just 6 senators have said they aren't running for re-election. And that is, I believe, it's mostly Republicans. However, when it comes to Congress, there are way more Democrats. They say you've got Senator Richard Burr, Republican, Pat Toomey, Republican, Rob Portman, Republican, Richard Shelby, a Republican, Roy Blunt, Republican, and Patrick Leahy, a Democrat. Here's the running list. We've got Ann Kirkpatrick. These are Democrats. Philemon Vela, Sherry Bustos, Tim Ryan, Charlie Crist, Val Demings, Connor Lamb. This is interesting. Lamb, 37, announced in August 2021 that he is running for the open Senate seat in his state. Lamb had only narrowly defeated his GOP challenger by just over 2 points in 2020 after he won a special election in 2018 to represent a district that had been held by a Republican, and that was Sean Parnell, who was running for the Senate, and then he dropped out over family issues. Ron Kind, Karen Bass, John Yarmuth, David Price, Mike Doyle, Anthony Brown, Jackie Speier, G.K. Butterfield, Peter Welch, Eddie Bernice Johnson, Tom Suozzi, Peter DeFazio, Alan Lowenthal, Stephanie Murphy, Albio Sires, Lucille Roybal Allard. 23 Democrats are not running. So it'll be interesting to see how this plays out. Now, it's still bad for Republicans because you've got 13 individuals, many individuals like Lee Zeldin and Mo Brooks, Tom Reed. Who else do we got? Billy Long, Anthony Gonzalez, Adam Kinzinger, as if he's actually a Republican. These people are all bowing out as well, including Louis Gohmert, 68, a former judge, announced in November that he is running for Texas Attorney General, joining a crowded GOP primary. Louis Gohmert's been pretty good. So this is still bad for Republicans, but the advantage is Republican. Not only do they have the historical advantage, they also did very well in 2020, shocking many of the pundits and pollsters, because there were districts that were safe blue. This was the craziest thing to me, notably Miami. Nobody thought Miami would go from Democrat to Republican. That seems impossible, and it did. Why? Well, you know, a lot of people who live down there, they kind of know the horrors of socialism, and they're watching it happen right now. Socialism among the Democratic Party, communism, authoritarianism, the leftism, all of that stuff, the diversity, inclusivity, and equity cult, it's freaking these people out because they've seen it before. So they're voting Republican. Again, I don't think voting Republican will save you from this, but maybe it will temporarily stave off the extremism from the Democrats. I don't know. I think it's funny that they claim the Republicans are the extreme ones. Republicans do nothing, literally nothing. They obstruct. Everyone's mad at Joe Manchin. He's a Democrat, but what did he do? Obstruct. Is he doing anything for the Republicans? No. He might change his party affiliation to independent. We'll see. I don't think he'll win. As somebody who lives in West Virginia, I do not believe Joe Manchin can win again. But, you know, I'm in one area, so who knows? Maybe for some reason he will end up winning again because people seem to like him. I just think, considering the polarization, it ain't going to happen. Now, as for what happens come 2024, I think Democrats are very, very worried because they don't have anybody. The Washington Post says panicked Democrats are ready to shove Biden aside again. Check out this quote. This is amazing. They say, 10 months into President Biden's term, panicky Democrats have already begun to speculate on who might take his place in 2024. A Post story last weekend contained this remarkable nugget, quote, one Democrat involved in campaigns said they couldn't think of a single person they had spoken to in the last month who considers the possibility of Biden running again to be a real one. Maybe so. But if there's one Democrat in Washington who isn't feeling panicky right now, I'm betting it's the president himself. Sure. Yeah, right. Maybe he's not panicky because he knows he's not going to run. But the Democrats are ready to boot them out. Joe Biden's unpopularity is so thick, you can cut it with a butter knife. Daily Mail says Nancy Pelosi is left flustered after protesters shouted, "Let's go, Brandon, USA," while she promoted Joe Biden's Build Back Better plan in San Francisco. His plan failed. It's got a whole bunch of insane garbled trash inside of it. And it's weird because, look, I'm not going to pretend to know everything that's in it. I'm not going to talk about whether we should or shouldn't have it for the most part. I will say there's bad things in it. But it's weird how tribal Democrats are. They're like, we got to get the infrastructure bill done. Even some progressives that I like. And I'm like, what in the bill are you super excited for? And I don't see any of that. I'm not saying every single Democrat. I don't want to fall into that trap. I'm just saying, for the most part, the fervor is tribal. Manchin is betraying this country. Who's the real president? Is it Joe Manchin or Joe Biden? And it's like, what? Manchin's representing West Virginia, dude. There's a Babylon Bee article. It's really funny. It's like, huge blow for democracy after bill fails due to, you know, majority vote or whatever. Like, the point is, they're complaining this is so bad for democracy when the majority of elected representatives voted against it or are against it. So that's how you know that these people are in the despotism camp. Look, you get Mitch McConnell, he appoints a lot of judges. Sure, I guess if you're a traditional conservative, it's a good thing. But what does he do? A whole lot of nothing. Democrats are pushing through policy and rapid transformative changes. Trump didn't even do this. The Build Back Better plan is massive. Trump didn't do this stuff. In many ways, Trump failed. Absolutely. In a lot of ways, he did good. But what we got from the Republicans was obstruction. That's it. Now, here's where things are getting interesting. I mentioned the earlier criminal referrals with the January 6th committee. We have this story from CNN. Trump accountant has testified before New York grand jury in criminal investigation, sources say. Let's get into the nitty gritty by citing Conta, Georges, and Buza PC, criminal defense, civil rights, and personal injury lawyers. I have no idea who these criminal lawyers are, but they have a website where they are selling legal services. And thus, not only do they very likely have the expertise to provide this service, they would have to be accurate in their reflection of what's going on and what services they provide when they provide those services. And on their website, this is johnbuzalaw.com, they explain how a grand jury works. They say, this is in New York, a grand jury in New York is composed of anywhere between 16 to 23 jurors. They hear testimony, and if 12 or more of them agree that a crime has been committed, they return an indictment. An indictment is a fancy word for accusation. Once a person is indicted, the case then proceeds to trial. In many states, including New York, you cannot proceed to trial on a felony complaint unless you've either been indicted or you've waived indictment. So it is a critical part of the process. There is no judge in the grand jury, nor is there a defense attorney. And the defendant isn't there unless he's testifying. The way the process works is the prosecutor asks the grand jury to consider charging a particular individual with whatever crime the prosecutor thinks the person committed. He then calls witnesses who establish the defendant committed the crime that the grand jury is considering. At the conclusion of all the evidence, the prosecutor then charges the grand jurors on the applicable law and leaves them to vote. They then vote on whether there is reasonable cause, legally probable cause, to believe a crime has been committed based on the testimony they've heard. This basically means that they determine whether it was more likely than not that the evidence establishes the defendant is guilty of a crime. If 12 or more grand jurors believe a crime has been committed, they vote an indictment. Conversely, if 12 or more don't believe a crime has been committed, they vote no true bill, which dismisses the case. The grand jury can also fail to reach an agreement, which means the prosecutor can call more witnesses if he wants to do so. Although a judge isn't there to oversee the proceedings, she does get a chance to review the minutes from the proceedings. If the prosecutor ended up doing something wrong, the judge can dismiss the indictment with leave for the prosecutor to represent. To put it simply, a grand jury very likely will return an indictment. It is that simple. There is no defense and there is no judge. The prosecutor can walk in and basically say whatever he wants. And he's going to say Donald Trump flubbed the value of his property so he could convince lenders to give him more money in loans to sustain his business. That's fraud. He'll show evidence. They've had people testify already and they'll say Donald Trump did believe his property was worth more than we thought or something to that effect. Then he'll say, if you believe Trump lied to people to secure loans, to defraud them into giving up money, then you must return an indictment. It seems extremely likely this will be the case. We know that we have more news on this issue from The Guardian. New York Attorney General vows Trump investigation will proceed undeterred. Former president sues Letitia James on grounds of political bias in efforts to halt inquiry into his business affairs. Trump is not taking this lying down. He's fighting back. But they're saying they're going to carry on. There's already a grand jury. The grand jury likely is already viewing the evidence. I mean, they've already had people testify, so not likely. They literally are already reviewing evidence. And I got to tell you, it's New York. How many people in New York in the Southern District in Manhattan are going to be like, I like Donald Trump? Okay, let's say 20%. Is 20% enough to save Donald Trump? No, unfortunately, it's not. So if you've got 23 jurors and you're looking at about five of them, a little bit less than five, maybe, saying, I like Trump. Well, then you've got 18, 17, 18, maybe 19 who are like, indict him. He's a bad guy. We don't like Trump. But maybe in New York, you get a bunch of regular people. Maybe you get a bunch of regular people and they don't play these stupid games. Maybe they're sick and tired of everything. And they say, dude, y'all are nuts. We need Trump back. Maybe. The AP reports from just about a week ago. District Attorney's last big decision, whether to charge Trump. They say after a dozen years in office, one piece of unfinished business remains for Manhattan DA Cyrus Vance Jr. before he retires at the end of the month. Will the prosecutor, known for his caution, go out with a bang by bringing criminal charges against Donald Trump? I believe the answer is yes, but we don't know. He's retiring at the end of this month, so would he issue an indictment before Christmas? Maybe. I think the goal of the indictment or any of these indictments is not to go after crime. I think it's to stop Donald Trump. An indictment will drain him of resources. But do they want to rally Trump supporters around him and cause tensions? I think the answer to that is no. Now, I don't know for sure. I don't know if it's 51% chance they indict him. It's a possibility. I will say grand juries typically do return indictments. But here's what I think could happen. It's Christmas. It's New Year's. I mean, this period after Christmas into New Year's is one of the worst. No joke. It's so difficult to get any work done. And I'm a workaholic. But everybody's kind of zoned out. You know, they're chilling. They had a big Christmas dinner. They got their presents. They are happy. And what happens? Big news is released. Trump is indicted. Sure, some people will see it. A lot of people. But most people won't. Because the TV's off and they're hanging out with their friends and family. So to indict Donald Trump just after or just before Christmas actually would be a powerful play. You'll jam him up. You'll drain him of resources. You will put him in a position where it's difficult for him to run for office. And you will not alert enough people to make it a PR benefit to Donald Trump. If they came out and indicted him now, I mean, a lot of people probably aren't paying attention. I mean, views, you know, ratings and stuff aren't so bad. But in the next couple of days, like today, it's probably going to start getting worse because people are starting to travel for the holidays. They're thinking about family. They're not thinking about news and politics. Now's the perfect time. If it was a month ago or a month from now, everyone would see it. It would be a huge news cycle story. At its peak, Trump supporters would rally. He'd raise millions of dollars. And he still might, even if he does get indicted. But we'll see. We will see. Because it could come any moment now. And at the very least, January 6th, we know where they're going. They're never going to stop the scandals. The insane, psychotic hearings they did all throughout the last year. It was mind-numbingly bad. Russiagate, Ukrainegate, now January 6th. Just stop, you lunatics. That's all they got, though. And CNN will love to put it on TV. So we'll see. I think they're just trying to obstruct and jam him up. But midterm election cycle is coming and Trump isn't the most prominent figure right now. It's going to be at your local level. It's going to be your primary. So take a look at when your primaries are and vote. I'll leave it there. Next segment's coming up tonight at youtube.com/TimcastIRL. That'll be at 8 p.m. Thanks for hanging out and we'll see you all then.